Good evening. It's good to be with you. This morning, Dr. John Lennox from Cambridge University, a great, great mathematician, spoke here refuting the claims of atheism in some delightful and very trenchant ways. But the most memorable moment for me is when he said, he quoted Richard Dawkins saying that faith in God is a fairy tale for people who are afraid of the dark. And John Lennox replied, atheism is a fairy tale for those afraid of the light, which I think is a good comeback. I'd like to read, he also made the point this morning that our very DNA is written all 3.5 billion letters of our DNA are written in exactly the right order. So we are written with the word. We are made in God's image. I'm just going to read briefly here from the Gospel of John. It's a very familiar passage, but it bears rereading and rehearing over and over. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So we all are very familiar with the theme of Christ being the incarnate Word. We seldom talk about another aspect of Christ, though. And I'd like to have us all read, and you'll notice that one of the words is in red. But let's read this together, and we're going to read a couple of verses from Genesis, a couple from Colossians, but let's read in unison. Okay, together. Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And from Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 and following, together. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And lastly, from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, together. In whose case the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelieving, so they may not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. So, this theme of glory is deeply, deeply embedded throughout the entire body of Scripture, Old and New Testament. It's something we barely comprehend. This word, this Hebrew word kabod, is very rich indeed. It's something that rolls off of our tongues, glory, very quickly. But do we really understand it? And I'm going to ask tonight that we maybe enter a little more deeply into this reality of God's glory. There's another word, a Greek word, that's used, and in some ways is interchangeable. It has its own nuance, kalos, beautiful, virtuous. It's interesting that the word beautiful in Greek is also deeply intertwined with virtue, with goodness. And I'll get into that more in a moment. So Christ, yes, Christ is the Word of God. He's the incarnate Word of God, but he is also the image and the glory of God. So I would say the beauty of God. So, a story about something beautiful we just read. I'll read it again. While he was in Bethany, at the home of Simon the leper, and reclining at the table, there came a woman with an alabaster vial of very costly perfume of pure nard. And she broke the vial and poured it over his head. But some were indignantly remarking to one another, why has this perfume been wasted? For this perfume might have been sold for over 300 denarii. And the money given to the poor, that's a year's wages. And they were scolding her, but Jesus said, let her alone. Why do you bother her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. Truly, I say to you, wherever the gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be spoken of her in her memory. Think about that for a moment. This anonymous woman, wherever the gospel is preached, this beautiful thing that she has done will be remembered. The poor are always here. We need to serve the poor. There's no lack of time to serve the poor. But we did not have that much time with Jesus when he was on earth. And she understood this. In fact, she anointed him with this costly perfume, understanding somehow intuitively that he wasn't going to be there, that at some point he was going to be taken. So I have this on the screen, and this is what I'd like to start with tonight in my talk. From Hans Urs von Balthasar, "We no longer dare to believe in beauty, and we make of it a mere appearance, the more easily to dispose of it. Our situation today shows that beauty demands for itself at least as much courage and decision as do truth and goodness. And she will not allow herself to be separated and banned from her two sisters without taking them along with herself in an act of mysterious vengeance. We can be sure that whoever sneers at her name, the name of beauty, as if she were a mere ornament of a bourgeois past, whether he admits it or not, such a one can no longer pray and soon will no longer be able to love." Von Balthasar, this is out of the introduction from the first of his 7-volume set on a theological aesthetics. It's his great magnum opus. He committed most of his work as a great theologian to examining the purpose, the reality, the glory of beauty as one of the 3 transcendent characteristics of God himself. So Christ, the beauty of God, we no longer dare to even believe in beauty in this world because there's so much pain, there's so much suffering, there's so much loss that the whole idea of spending our lives in the pursuit of beauty seems frivolous because we've diminished beauty to be something one can buy in a convenience store to change one's appearance or off a magazine rack. Standardizing it, turning it into something superficial. But the beauty that von Balthasar is talking about here is the beauty of God. And how did we see this beauty? We saw it in the near, as this woman is pouring out this perfume on Jesus, he's about to be buried, he says. And then we know what happened after that. He went to the cross. He was marred beyond recognition. From the Isaiah passage, the famous passage, he was disfigured, not one that we would look at with any attractiveness, but he was stricken, he was smitten for our afflictions, and by his wounds we are healed. The prophet prophesied that the coming one, the Messiah, would be someone who was marred, whose visage was marred, not someone that we would conventionally call pretty. But the beauty that von Balthasar is drawing us to, and that I'd like to meditate with us tonight on, is a profound broken beauty. Broken because the one who is the source of all glory was broken for us. So, there's a word in Greek that we now use all the time, symbol, or symbolon, but the word symbol. You know what a symbol is. It's a kind of container of many layers of meaning, many levels, many qualities of meaning, right? When we symbolize something, we try to capture a lot of meaning in one word or one image, right? But originally, a symbol was an object. It was a little tile about the size of your thumb called a tessera hospitalis, a tile of welcome. What would happen is you would take this little tile, often in the form of a little handshake, and when a stranger or a newcomer came to your home, before they crossed the threshold into your house to have dinner with you, you would break the tile and you would give them half. And you would say to them something like this: "Henceforth, you and anyone with whom you share this piece of tile is welcome in my home, but the two pieces must be fitted together perfectly." So the word symbol was originally an object that was broken as a tile of welcome, a tessera hospitalis. And the two pieces are fitted together. And even for generations, if that piece of tile is passed on, those people are welcome. So the depth of hospitality, can you imagine? But somehow there was an intuitive understanding that when you crossed that threshold, something needed to be broken. Not just the bread that you would break with them, but something symbolically costly. It's so interesting that at the Lord's Last Supper, before he was in fact taken and beaten and scourged beyond recognition and then hung on a cross, that he said, "This is my body broken for you." Welcoming us, those of us who are broken, those of us who don't feel that we belong, who feel that there's no way we're going to be welcomed at the table of God. He's saying, "Yes, I am broken for you. And you now hold the peace that must be fitted together with mine. And you will be with me in my kingdom. I will come and I will sup with you." But what I'd like to say tonight is there's another way of approaching this too, which is, how do we apprehend beauty? How do we get to that profound, broken beauty that von Balthasar was talking about that requires as much courage and decision as truth and goodness? Well, for me, as a painter, as an artist, it's not in propositional rhetoric. It's not in fine-sounding arguments. It's not as important as arguments are, as important as logic is. And we know, thankfully, for people like the great mathematician John Lennox, who spoke this morning, without logic, we founder in this world. We need to be thinkers. As he said this morning, we need to think about thought itself and understand that the source of thought is Christ, the Logos, which is the word, the basis of logic. But for me as a painter, my primary way of coming close to God, of crossing over that threshold and fitting the piece of the tile together with his, is through beauty. It's through art, through poetry. And I believe that, like the preaching of the word, which I'm doing tonight, but I'm also preaching the image tonight, Christ, the image of God, through the word, there is a fresh way of approaching Christ. And as we reach for ways of getting beyond propositional thought, we reach for things like paintings, poetry, music. And I'm going to recite a little bit from T.S. Eliot's poem, Four Quartets, right now, and then I'll try to unpack it a bit. It's pretty dense with imagery, but just let the images hang in the air here. This is from the second part of the first section of the poem, entitled Burnt Norton. He says, "Garlic and sapphires in the mud clot the bedded axle tree. The trilling wire in the blood sings below inveterate scars, appeasing long-forgotten wars. The dance along the artery, the circulation of the lymph are figured in the drift of stars. Ascend to summer in the tree. We rise above the moving tree and light upon the figured leaf. And here upon the sodden floor below, the boarhound and the boar pursue their pattern as before, but reconciled among the stars. At the still point of the turning world, neither flesh nor fleshless, neither from nor towards, at the still point, there the dance is." Okay, so pretty dense imagery. Let me unpack it just a little bit. Garlic and sapphires in the mud clot the bedded axle tree. What is he talking about? What is the poet reaching for here? He's pushing the language to break open so that it spills meaning in multiple directions, so that it's not just a straightforward propositional statement like, "It is light out," or "It is dark out." Garlic and sapphires in the mud. Garlic is a stinky but spicy, tasty thing. Kind of like human beings. But a sapphire, I don't know if you've seen a perfectly polished star sapphire, often cut in the shape of a clove of garlic, a little oval-like shape, and there's a little star sparkling right in the middle of a deep azure blue. It's a beautiful gem. Often found in Afghanistan, I guess. There's a great number of sapphires come from Afghanistan. But picture this for a minute. A stinky, spicy, smelly garlic and sapphire together. Earth and heaven, human, divine, in the mud, clot the bedded axle tree. The axle tree is literally in a carriage or in a car. You have the axle and you have the drive shaft. It's actually, if you turn it up right side up, it's the shape of a cross. Garlic and sapphire in the mud clot the bedded axle tree. The trilling wire in the blood sings below inveterate scars, appeasing long-forgotten wars. The dance along the arteries, the circulation of the lymph are figured in the drift of stars. Our own bodies reflect the heavens, the movement of the stars, the rising of the sun, the moon glowing at night. Our own lymph system, our circulatory system, our bodies are an image of the entire cosmos. Not only that, we still, despite sin, we are the image of God on earth. Broken, marred, yes. But this is really important, that we reclaim that image of Christ in us. So I'm going to recite one more bit from Eliot's poem, and then I'll explain why I'm dwelling on T.S. Eliot here. Okay, this is from the very last stanza of Four Quartets, from a section of the poem called Little Gidding. Now, Eliot wrote this part of the poem when the bombs were falling out of the sky on London during World War II. He was an air warden, so he was very familiar. He had to stay awake, and he had to make sure people knew to take cover. There's a place in the poem, actually before the part that I'm going to recite, just before it, he says, the dove descending breaks the air with flame of incandescent terror, of which the tongues declare the one discharged from sin or error is choice of pyre or pyre, to be redeemed from fire by fire. So he's actually describing the falling of those bombs. The dove descending breaks the air with flame of incandescent terror. So fire was a strong imagery in this poem. He actually dwelled on all four of the cardinal elements from the medieval mind, earth, air, fire, and water. But Little Gidding, the last part of the poem, is really an embodiment of that element of fire, but the divine fire, the fire of divine love. And he says at the very end, with the drawing of this love and the voice of this calling, we shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. Through the unknown remembered gate, when the last of earth left to discover is that which was the beginning, at the source of the longest river, the voice of the hidden waterfall, and the children in the apple tree, not known because not looked for, but heard, half heard, in the stillness between two waves of the sea. Quick, now, here, now, always, a condition of complete simplicity, costing not less than everything. And all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well when the tongues of flame are enfolded into the crowned knot of fire, and the fire and the rose are one. Powerful imagery. I know it's hard to take in, but listen to this again. With the drawing of this love and the voice of this calling, we shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. He talks about this source of the longest river. What's the longest river? It's the river that flows out of Eden. It's also the river of life flowing in the new renewed kingdom, the new renewed heavens and renewed earth. And the fire is the fire of divine love. The rose is the symbol in medieval times of the church. So the fire and the rose are one at the end. He says, a condition of complete simplicity, costing not less than everything. So why do we reach for poetry? Why do we reach for paintings, for music, when words fail us? Because we are human beings who are heart, mind, soul. We are not just a mind dragging a body behind it. We live in our bodies. Our bodies, we will resurrect in our bodies. Our bodies will be renewed, refreshed, made brand new. But it's in our bodies that we experience grace. It's in our bodies, it's with one another that we know love. It's not a head trip. It has to be the whole person. And so poetry, music, art, complete that part of us that mere explanations cannot give us. We know that. There's a whole part of our life that's lived below the threshold of language, or possibly above the threshold of language. Language cannot contain it. You've all been, I've seen some head nodding, we've all been there where we can't say the thing we're trying to say. So I recommend memorizing C.S. Eliot. It helps me. I mean, obviously you'd need to read this poem a lot to begin to really sift and sort through it, and I'm not going to spend all evening unpacking that bit, but I want to talk to you a little bit about a project I've been working on. It's a collaboration with another painter by the name of Makoto Fujimura, and a composer by the name of Christopher Theophanides, and a theologian by the name of Jeremy Begbie. The three artists got together and, by the generosity of some patrons of the arts, were commissioned to do original paintings and original music for in response to T.S. Eliot's four quartets. And this this project has been touring around the country. It's gone to eight different cities here in the States. It's currently in Hong Kong, and then it goes to Cambridge University in England for Holy Week this coming year during Easter season, and then from there to Japan. It's been touring around the world, and what we found in each location, the exhibition looks different, the reception is different, and yet there's great enthusiasm, and somehow Eliot's poetry just seems to vibrate. Even if you don't fully comprehend it, you feel it. It feels true. It feels right. What I'd like to do now is I'd like to share little bits from our exhibition. This is from a composition that Chris wrote. Chris, by the way, teaches graduate composition at Yale University. He's a really humble man and a truly gifted man. His work has been performed all over the world. You'd never know what to talk to him. He's not at all full of himself. He doesn't take himself seriously at all, but he certainly takes his music seriously. So this is the title of this piece is At the Still Point. Here, this is a handwritten page from the first part called In My Beginning Is My End. Can we have the volume on that? Okay, try it again. There we go. Feel the tension building. This growing, swelling kind of tension in this figure, da 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 da, over and over again, and it functions like the beat, almost like a clock ticking. And then there's this disruptive element that comes in. It goes and rips it apart. And this happens throughout the poem. This kind of beat that becomes almost like the experience we have of time, that's regularized by the ticking of the clock. But that's not how we experience time, is it? We refer to the clock in order to make our appointments, but we experience time as speeding up and slowing down, and sometimes stopping. Narnia time, where 1,000 years can go by in a moment, right? So, this is what music does. Music expresses something we can't possibly put into words. Listen to this beginning of the second movement. Very different. More lyrical. So in the third movement, there's this kind of return to the tension that was in the first movement, but it's lightened somehow by the journey that you've taken through the second movement. And finally, in the fourth movement, another quotation from Eliot's poem, "The world becomes stranger, the pattern more complicated." Chris is trying to reveal to us something that doesn't resolve. So it's not a neat package deal, because that's the way we experience life. Life sometimes is upsetting. It doesn't necessarily resolve like it does in a Hollywood movie. But it's real. You can hear some of that same figure again. Da 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 da. It's repeated. It comes back and revisited. And by the end of the piece, it's 35 minutes long. I can't play any more for you tonight, but hopefully you can encounter this work at some point performed live. Mia Chung, who used to be a member of the church here, has performed it in New York, in Massachusetts, also out in California with her string quartet. But at the very end, Chris's music breathes this kind of very soft breath, and you feel like it's a human body finally expiring or resting, finding rest. My colleague Mako Fuchimura also produced some work for this show, and he based his four large paintings on part of the text from the second section of the poem called East Coker. And it goes something like this: "Oh, dark, 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 they all go into the dark. The merchants, the bankers, the men of letters, all the illustrious people, they all go into the dark." It's a very depressing part of the poem. But Mako claims that after he couldn't go home because he lived at Ground Zero in Tribeca, when the planes flew into the buildings and the buildings came down, he couldn't go home and he was totally disoriented. He was able to find his children as stuff was raining through the air and get them to safety, and he was able to link up with his wife, and they actually came and stayed with us for a while up in Gloucester. But Mako claims that by reading this very dark passage in Eliot, he was somehow comforted. To know that a poet can give voice to our heart's cry. You think about some of those imprecatory psalms of King David. They're dark psalms. They're the hard ones, where the King David, as a great poet, is pouring out his heart to God and saying, "All my enemies are laying a trap for me. There's no hope for me right now, yet I will return to you, O God." Over and over again, we hear in those darker psalms, and if you've read through psalms, you know what I'm talking about. So these are the paintings that Mako devised. They don't translate really well on a screen, but they're vibrant in their darkness. He spent a long time perfecting this particular dark ground for the painting that had mica mixed into it, so that when you stand in front of the painting, you feel enveloped by this velvety darkness, and yet you feel light pulsing in the midst of it. Mako has said on a number of occasions when we've exhibited together these paintings, he said, "I made these dark paintings as a frame for Bruce's paintings. I wanted to serve Bruce and to serve his work." That's what collaboration is. We're all servants of the work, but we're also servants of one another. So I chose a passage from the end that I recited to you, "And children in the apple tree, not known because not looked for, but heard, half heard in the stillness between two waves of the sea. Quick now, here now, always, a condition of complete simplicity, costing not less than everything." So there were originally four children in this tree. This is an 8-foot-tall painting, about 5 feet wide. They were life-size figures. They're my four grandchildren. And they were fully painted like the little boy in the top branch there. But eventually, I kept looking at the painting and decided, you know, it doesn't fit. Because in both places of the poem where children are mentioned, they're there and not there. So I covered over my two granddaughters and my other grandson with silver and gold. So they're still there, shimmering. Actually, if you get up close to the painting and touch it, you can feel the bumpy area where the paintings of the children are. But they're covered with leaves, gold leaves, silver leaves. This was spring. There's a close-up of the child for me, who is the symbol of earth and spring, and then summer, ascend to summer in the tree, we rise above the moving tree in light upon the figured leaf, and here upon the sodden floor below, the boarhound and the boar pursue their pattern as before, but reconciled among the stars. The dance along the artery, the circulation of the lymph are figured in the drift of stars. You know, that kind of imagery was very much there when I was thinking of painting her back, and I had originally painted a tattoo on her back of the tree, but as I kept painting it, it kept resembling scars, and then I realized that's what it was supposed to be. You know, in beauty, there's often the history of a person's life, in true beauty, in broken beauty, and even someone who is scarred. This is my autumn painting, and the woman who posed for this is the dean of students at Northeastern University, Betty Freeman, African-American woman of great dignity, a great leader in this Boston community. But she's a woman without fear, and she's in waist-deep water. Maybe there's been a flood. The tree is denuded of its leaves. In fact, some of the branches almost look like scars themselves. But she's unafraid. And then finally, the winter painting, Makoto Fujimura's father, Osamu Fujimura, is depicted. And I loved painting his face because at the end, he looked like he had the gaze of a young boy. And the young boy, at the beginning, had the face of an old man, had the gaze of an old man. In my end is my beginning, Eliot says throughout the poem. So I think we're running out of time. I had hoped to show you some of the, I'll just take a quick blazing tour. These are my grandchildren. They posed for me. The boys were up in the tree, as they always are. And then in Photoshop, I composited it to create a new tree that didn't really exist, and I actually placed the children in the tree who hadn't actually been there. Then I worked on it some more. This is completely invented, and then changed it and altered it to resemble one of my backgrounds, the abstracted backgrounds. And what you see is the beginnings of this 8-foot-tall painting. The silver and the gold, the sketching, the layering of paint. Finally, the fully developed figures. Then the figures gradually disappearing under the silver leaf. Then completely gone. And then the changing of the light in the final painting. So what I've tried to do tonight is show you that images, poetry, and music can embody that broken beauty, which is the beauty of Christ. All these people are believers. They're all people who have dedicated their life to their work as servants of Christ, as artists. And we're presenting this to you. You need to present your half of the piece for there to be meaning. This isn't us expressing ourselves. This is us breaking our work and ourselves for you. You need to put your piece together with the puzzle so we can make meaning together. Can we close in prayer? Our God, we come to you as broken people. We know, Lord, in our heart of hearts that we are not worthy to be called even your servants. But as prodigal children, we turn to you, our generous Father, who accepts us, who gives us entrance, who allows us to come to his table. We thank you, Lord, for the costliness of your sacrifice. It cost you everything for us to come. Thank you, Lord, for being broken for us. We pray that you would, in your own way, Lord, help us to allow ourselves to be broken for the life of the world, for we are your body in the world. We praise you and we thank you for your great beauty. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Thank you.